Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassirli amri wa ahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, dear brothers and friends.
Alaykum salam.
I want to begin by thanking Manchester University Islamic Society for inviting me today to deliver a lecture on the history of the Ottomans. I believe practically every book or talk or lecture should begin with the story of Osman's dream. Now, Osman was the founder of the Ottoman Empire, and he had a dream. He had a dream before the establishment of the state in 1299. He had a dream before he became the Sultan. He was once staying around the house of a renowned Sufi scholar called Sheikh Edebali, who later on became his father-in-law. So when he had this dream, he saw the crescent leave the chest of Sheikh Edebali and enter his chest. And when that crescent entered his chest, a tree grew from his navel. And that tree continued to grow. And in that dream, he saw the river Danube, the river Tigris, the river Nile, the river Euphrates, as well as some very famous mountains, the Caucasus and so forth. And the tree carried on growing. You all have a handout which has the dream in more detail. That was basically a bit paraphrased. So the crescent which left the chest of Sheikh Edebali represented Islam. And the tree which spread and continued to grow represented the state or the empire which Osman and his descendants were going to rule. That was more or less the dream of Osman. And you find that successive rulers, Ottoman rulers, one after another, strive towards fulfilling this dream, making it a reality, spreading that state, spreading that empire, and making it uniquely Islamic. Remember, the dream wasn't just a tree that never stopped growing. The crescent represented Islam. That's Osman's dream. Always have that dream in mind in context to some of the policies and politics of the Ottoman rulers that we're going to discuss later on in this lecture. So if you look at the origin of the Ottomans, obviously they were Turks, and they migrated westward from Central Asia. So obviously Central Asia, modern-day Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan, and so forth. And they migrated westward because of the Mongols. Because the Mongols at the time were wreaking havoc in Asia, and they were literally conquering land one after another, so they moved westward. And the Ottomans date their lineage back to the Ottomans. So the Ottomans were part of the Oghuz branch of Turks. And they date their specific tribe before they were known as the Osmanli or the Ottomans as the Kings. Now for those of you who are watching the hit series, you know that before the Ottomans became the Ottomans, they were the Kings. Now, it's historically questionable how authentic that is, but for the sake of consistency with Ottoman chroniclers, we'll say that they did come from the Kayes. And the Kayes, when they moved westward, they eventually settled in Anatolia. Now the classical region of Anatolia is far bigger than it is today. It more or less represented mainland Turkey. And they were given protection under the Seljuk Sultanate of Rome. Now, the Seljuk Sultanate of Rome were Turks themselves, and it was the western flank of the Seljuk Empire. And they were very loyal subjects. They were very loyal. They were given protection. They should protect the frontier. They fought many battles under the banner of the Seljuks. But in the mid to late 13th century, we started seeing the decline of the Seljuk Sultanate. And then as a result of that, we started seeing the emergence of independent, autonomous beyliks. Now, beyliks is basically a principality. It's a small, autonomous state. And increasingly, we start seeing more of those as the Seljuks decline and then eventually demise. And then from one of the beyliks, the Anatolian beyliks, was the Osmanli beylik, which then, within a very short period of time, evolved into the Ottoman Sultanate. Now, brothers, sisters, and friends, you have to appreciate that Ottoman history, it covers a vast period of time. It's 625 years. Entire books and studies have been committed and commissioned on this topic. Therefore, I cannot give it justice in 45 or 50 minutes, but I will try my best, inshallah. And ultimately, it began in 1299, the establishment of the Ottoman Sultanate in Somut. And then up to 1517, that was when the Ottoman Empire declared itself as the Caliphate, which was then abolished in 1924. So we're looking at 623 years of the Sultanate, or 407 years of the Caliphate, all together is 625 years. That's a lot to cover. And in all honesty, for those of you who have read in Ottoman history, you'll find that events, incidents, wars, policy changes, and so forth, it's vast. However, from this period of 625 years, I've picked out a number of dates and incidents which I think we should all take note of, at least, and this again is from the handout. So of course, 1299, we saw the establishment of the Sultanate under Osman I in the city of Sogut. We then saw between 1402 to 1413 the Ottoman interregnum, or the civil war, with the three sons of Sultan Bayezid I. And this 11-year civil war nearly destroyed the state from within. And of course, 1453, we had the conquest of Constantinople. And this date is very important, and it's a milestone for Muslims worldwide. Why? Because a prophecy of the beloved Prophet Muhammad, when he gave the glad tidings and he prophesied the conquest of Constantinople. And that hadith was narrated by Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, who's also buried in Istanbul. And that prophecy was that Constantinople will be conquered, and the ruler and the army who do it will be a blessed ruler and a blessed army. So 1453 and the conquest of Constantinople is a huge milestone, a huge date in Islamic history. In 1517, Selim I declared the Ottoman Empire as the Caliphate after he defeated the Mamluks in the Battle of Majdabik, and it was the Mamluks who were protecting the Abbasid Caliph at the time. And Mutawakkil III, who was the last Abbasid Caliph, was forcibly made to abdicate. And then when the Hijaz came under the rule of the Ottomans, that's when Selim I became the first Khalif of the Ottoman Empire. Then you had a period of 28 years of peace between 1740 to 1768. And the reason why I've included this in the timeline is because I personally believe, from my reading, my limited reading, is that decline began in this period. Now some of you may be thinking, well, hold on, 28 years of peace, you think times were good. Yeah, they were good. But as a result of having no major military campaigns, you understand why, but that is when I feel that decline, at least from land expansion, had begun. 1839 to 1876, we saw the movement of the Tanzimat, which were major secular modernization reforms. It began under Muhammad II, and then of course you had the first constitutional amendments in 1876. Then in 1909, you had the end of the Sultan of Khalif's executive rule under Abdul Hamid II. He was the last Ottoman ruler to have executive absolute rule over the empire. In 1914, under the power and authority of the Young Turks movement, the Ottoman Empire entered World War I on the side of the Germans, and they lost. In 1922, the Ottoman Sultanate was dissolved by the National Assembly, led by Kemal Ataturk. In 1923, we had the Treaty of Lausanne, where the Allied forces, namely Britain and France, annexed former Ottoman territories. And in 1924, we had the abolishment of the Ottoman Caliphate. Now these are, I feel, are some very important dates. Many things have been missed out, but from my reading and my research, I felt these are very important dates to take note of to understand Ottoman history. Notable rulers. So, just like how the history of the Ottomans is very vast and long-standing, similarly there were many, many rulers. In total, there were 36 sultans. From the 36 sultans, 28 of them were also caliphs. So, the first 8 Ottoman rulers were not khulafa, they were not khalifs, they were sultans. Selim I, who was the 9th Ottoman ruler, was Khalif and Sultan. And you'll see throughout the lecture, I use these terms interchangeably, unless I specifically use the term Sultan for the first 8. Osman I, ruled from 1299 to 1323, regarded as the father of the state. Murad I, ruled between 1362 to 1389, known as the Consolidator. He was the grandson of Osman I. He was known as the Consolidator because of two things. He practically conquered the entirety of Rumelia, which is modern-day Balkans. He also created the first elite infantry unit known as the Janissary Corps. Then, of course, we have Mehmed II, the conqueror, who was prophesied. And he ruled in two intervals, 1444 to 1446 and 1451 to 1481. It's also important to add that it was Mehmed II, the conqueror, who also introduced the policy of royal fratricide, which was a practice of Ottoman princes before they took leave in the empire of killing their brothers with a silk rope. We'll discuss that later. Selim I, the first caliph, his son, Suleiman I, known as the Magnificent amongst the Europeans and known as the lawgiver within the Ottoman Empire, or Al-Qanuni. And the reason why he was known as Al-Qanuni, or the lawgiver, was because he essentially put together the first Ottoman constitutional canons, and he got rid of a number of tribal Turkic laws, and he also set up the remit and the span of the scholars and the qudha, the judges. Amongst Western scholars and academics, they will say that he was the first secular ruler. I unequivocally disagree. It was merely a case of him fully setting out the remit of the law while giving a dynamic role to the Islamic scholars and the judges of his time. Who's been to Istanbul here? What's that lovely mosque opposite Hagia Sophia?
Sultan Ahmed.
So Ahmed I built that mosque. That area is called Sultan Ahmed, and he was most famously known for ending the policy of fratricide. Then you had Murad IV, who ruled between 1623 to 1640. He was known as the Puritan. And the reason why he was known as the Puritan is because he outlawed and prohibited stuff like coffee shops, smoking tobacco, public baths known as hammams. And by the way, the hammams of then are not like the hammams of today, not that I know. The hammams of the past were public baths for those who could not afford water and were not able to make ghusl and make wudu. So that was the use of public baths, but he banned those because the whole order and segregation issue. He banned breweries that used to produce wine for the Jews and Christians. He outlawed all of that. Hence he was known as the Puritan. The Sultan Murad IV is also well known because he was the last Ottoman ruler to have led the armies directly by himself. After this practice, this tradition was lost. Prior to him, every Ottoman ruler had led the armies at the forefront. Selim III, who ruled between 1789 to 1807, was known as the Reformer because he was the first Ottoman ruler to have at least intended, to have radically reformed Ottoman state law with an idea of it imitating or at least taking from the West at the time. He was assassinated by the Janissary corps, because one of the reforms he wanted to do was get rid of the Janissary corps. So he was assassinated. But very shortly after, under Sultan Mahmud II, who ruled between 1808 to 1839, who's known as the Modernist, he put into effect the planned reforms of Selim III. And he essentially created the movement of the Tanzimat, in 1839. And the Tanzimat reform was then implemented in the first constitution of 1876. There were a number, a plethora of reforms, just to name you some of them. He wanted to get rid of the millet system. The millet system was a legal procedure whereby Jews and Christians in their respective areas were allowed to resolve their disputes according to their own religious law. He wanted to get rid of the Janissary courts because he felt that they became too corrupt and too powerful, and they didn't embody or reflect a modern army. He also made a number of military reforms in terms of uniform, in terms of getting rid of the beard and implementing the moustache and so forth. These are just some of the reforms that he had effectively put in. And of course he began the Tanzimat reforms. And last but not least, Abdul Hamid II, who ruled between 1876 and 1909. He was known as the last great caliph. The reason why he was known as the last great caliph, not just within the Ottoman Empire but beyond, is because he had a very pan-Islamic outlook. He wanted the entire global Muslim population to unite behind his leadership and the Ottoman state from the religious perspective of the Khilafah. Now, that's not to say that previous rulers, Ottoman rulers, didn't want this, but he put a strong emphasis on this religious obligation of Muslims uniting behind the Khalif and supporting the Khilafah to the extent where he would reach out to the Muslims of India and in Africa during the period of European colonialism to counter certain advancements by European powers at the time. So, brothers, sisters and friends, After 36 sultans and 28 caliphs, these are the 10 that came to mind. Capitals. So there were four capitals of the Ottoman Empire. Sobut, between 1299 to 1335, regarded as the birthplace of the Ottoman Empire. Bursa, 1335 to 1363, which was more westward towards Istanbul, and that was conquered by Murad I. Then you have Erbil, known in the Greek as Adrianopolis, between 1363 to 1453, and of course the last capital of the state, which was Constantinople, Istanbul, 1453 to 1924, best part 450 years. All of these cities are in modern-day Turkey. Now, if you were to ask me, had the Ottomans taken any major cities in the east or the west, I would humbly argue that I don't think they would have ever moved their capital from Istanbul or Constantinople, unless it was Rome. The reason why that is because Constantinople, Istanbul, had a huge religious significance within the global Muslim nation, because it was a prophecy. And along with Constantinople, another city which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had prophesied its conquest was Rome. So unless they took Rome, I don't think they would have taken any other, moved their capital city from Constantinople. Just a bit of, you know, context there. Characteristics of the state. Now, the Ottoman Empire was indeed a religious state. It was an Islamic state. And we just need to look at Osman's dream and the way that dream was interpreted. The role of the crescent symbolizing Islam. Well, the fact that from the very inception of the state, that the state law was essentially entirely Hanafi. It was influenced by Maturidi theology, and it was also influenced by Sufi tariqas, namely the Naqshbandi movement. And this was discussed at great length by Hussein Yilmaz in his book, The Caliphate Redefined, where he discussed that unlike other dynasties or those who have claimed the caliphate, like the Umayyads and the Abbasids, the Ottoman state was uniquely and distinctly Hanafi, and it was distinctly influenced by Maturidi theology, as well as the proliferation of a number of Sufi movements and tariqas, namely the Naqshbandis. But it was also very Turk. It was unapologetically Turkish, but it was pan-Islamic in its outlook. And we know this because the state language was not Arabic or Persian. It was Ottoman Turkish. Now, Ottoman Turkish was heavily influenced by both Arabic and Persian. And it was an expansionist state. And when I say expansionist, I'm going to make a distinction that when I say expansionist, it wasn't from the kind of the European colonial perspective of expansionist. It was more an expansionist from the perspective that the state perceived its expansion as a religious duty. And again, I refer back to Osman's dream. That tree did not stop growing from his navel. In fact, the motto of the Ottoman Empire was the eternal state. As successive rulers, as I mentioned in the previous slide, wanted to fulfill this vision. It was a very militaristic state. And we knew this from the way they created the Janissary Corps. Or the huge importance that the state had exerted on the concept of jihad fi sabilillah, from its madrasas to the mosques, to everyday society, to the concept of martyrdom that was praised, and the families of those who had died in military campaigns were given a lot of honor and respect in society, and also the importance that the Ottoman Empire had exerted on the role of military conscription. In that regard, it was a very militaristic state. It was also a tolerant and pluralistic state. And to be honest, there was no other empire or polity at its time that whereby Christians, Jews and Muslims had not just coexisted, but Jews and Christians had flourished in their respective trades. Christians had a number of senior positions within the government, right? And this was, quite frankly, unheard of. It was unheard of within the British Empire, the Russian Empire, the Habsburg, the Holy Roman Empire. To hear a Muslim or a Jew to have such a high position or even a role, it was unheard of. So in that regard, it was truly a pluralistic state for its time, and of course it had a millet system, whereby Jews and Christians in their respective areas were allowed to sort their disputes out according to their religious law. But this was a tradition that was maintained by previous dynasties, and some of our even date back all the time to the Prophet Muhammad, the Prophet of Peace. And lastly, the Ottomans were very well known for their administrative capabilities, in that the state had covered three continents. Africa,
Europe,
and Asia. So it was very, very diverse, ethnically, racially, religiously, but still, yeah, I'm not wrong. In that regard, the way it managed to run such a vast empire methodically was truly impressive for its time. And two of the ways in which he did this was the utilization of a lot, in the way that jizya or zakah was collected and then distributed and then utilized for the development and the establishment of Islamic institutions, madrasas, looking after the widows, the orphans, the building of public hammams and so forth, as well as the taxation system. If you think about it, in those times, so let's talk about 15th, 16th century. For an empire of the size of the Ottomans to collect tax in a manner in which there was no gates to corruption, which I'm sure there was, and certainly wasn't in that period, it was unheard of. It was unheard of because no empire at its time had covered the lands that the Ottomans did, yet they managed to collect tax and distribute tax and utilize it for the progression and for the advancement of their state. Now, this Ottoman coat of arms more or less depicts the characteristics of the Ottoman state. It was created by Abdulhamid II in 1882, so it was very, very modern and very late within the empire. And it more or less symbolizes everything that the characteristics of the things I've just discussed. So you've got Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the top, that little circle, then you've got the Kubra, which is the emblem of the Sultan. You've got the two flags, the red flag representing the Ottoman Sultanate, primarily Turkish. The green flag, which represents the Caliphate. You can't see it, but there's three crescents. The three crescents represent Africa, Asia, and Europe. And then, of course, you've got the cannons, the spears, the guns, the navy emblem. In that regard, it was a very militaristic state. So everything which I've just discussed is depicted in that coat of arms there. Achievements. There are a number of achievements, a number of things that the Ottomans did, which should be mentioned, and again, there are many things, but things that came to mind is what you see on the screen there. So number one, it was the first gunpowder empire, along with the Mughal Empire and the Safavid Empire. Prior to them, no state or polity had utilized gunpowder in terms of firearms and cannons. They created the first modern elite military corps, the Janissaries. And just to tell you a bit about who the Janissary corps were. They were created under Murad I, and they, over a quick period of time, became the military elite of Ottoman society. And they had three objectives. Number one, to bodyguard and protect the ruler. Number two, to protect the state. Number three, to make sure that the state was in a constant state of expansion. So whenever there was a time when there were no military campaigns, you'd hear about a Janissary rebellion or an uprising, because they were ultimately paid soldiers who lived in the barracks. But they became very powerful and very influential over time. They were very well organized. When they went in the front line, they were used as police within the empire. And they got so powerful towards the 17th and 18th century, where they practically decided who would become the Sultan or the Khalif. And they were a formidable force. They gave Europeans nightmares, in the sense that the way that they were organized and the way that they would approach battle was something which was unheard of at the time. And some historians have compared the Janissary corps to the modern day National Guard. So when you hear about the Iranian Revolutionary Guard or the Saudi National Guard, or even in the Western context, the SAS or whatever they may be, many of them date back its structure and its organization to the Janissary corps. Bit of a mouthful here. It was also, the Ottoman Empire was basically the first cosmopolitan, multi-ethnic, religiously pluralistic empire in Europe. And because it truly was, for the reasons I explained in the previous slide, because of the millet system, because of the fact that Christians had significant roles to play within the empire, within the government, the fact that they were allowed to sort out their disputes according to their own laws, the fact that it wasn't just a case of coexistence. It wasn't. It really wasn't. And it was incomparable to any other part of the world at that time, where those three Abrahamic faiths had lived in more than relative peace. And of course it was under the reign and authority of the Ottomans, with the permission of Allah, that Islam came to Central and Eastern Europe. Of course we had Islam in Spain for the best part of 800 years, but in terms of the Balkans or modern day, you know, Bosnia, or Romania, Bulgaria, Serbia, Kosovo, Albania, Islam was not in these places before the Ottomans. It was through the Ottomans that Islam came to these lands. And where even after the demise of the Ottoman Empire, people still held on to their faith. And you find Muslims in these countries till today. And of course, they were also known for protecting the Mediterranean. Now, I know there's this whole kind of misconception that pirates were black or Arabs. No. The first piracy movements were European. And it was the Ottomans who protected the Mediterranean Sea. Who's heard of Barbarossa? Yeah. Barbarossa was commissioned by the Ottoman Empire to protect the Mediterranean Sea, whereby Spain and France and the Venetian Empire at the time were set out or commissioned raids on traders and merchants in the Mediterranean Sea. It was the Ottomans who protected those seas. A number of construction work took place in Masjid al-Aqsa, Dome of the Rock, in Medina. For those of you who have been Medina, there's a train station there which was created by the Ottomans. A lot of the calligraphy, a lot of the work that was done in the Dome of the Rock was done under Caliph Suleiman I. To name just a few things, they did a lot of construction and a lot of building in Sham, in Al-Aqsa, and in the Hijaz. They welcomed the Jews after the Spanish Inquisition. And not only did they welcome the Jews, they allowed them to set up their businesses, flourish in those businesses, set up their own neighborhood and their quarters. To the extent that towards the end of the Ottoman Empire, that Jewish financial advisors used to be regularly consulted with regards to fiscal policies. Again, unheard of. Not the European Empire opened their doors to the Jews, it was the Ottomans. Till today, you've got to Istanbul, you find a Jewish quarter, whereby there are Jewish members of the society that have been there since the period of Inquisition, or at least they are the descendants of those. And there's two things I wanted to kind of include, I'm a bit geeky in that. But under Abdul Hamid II, he commissioned the creation of the blueprint of the first robot, and it was sent to Japan. You can see on the right there. Unfortunately, it didn't materialize, but who knows? All the robots came out in Japan, maybe to find the Ottomans for it, if you ever did. And there's a picture there of the Janissary Corps in the 17th century. And last but not least, under Abdul Hamid II, there was a blueprint to build a train line from Istanbul to go all the way through to the Levant, to Jerusalem, all the way to Hijaz. And again, this reflects the very pan-Islamic view that Abdul Hamid II had in terms of tying in three major regions and three major cities to exert the role and the authority and the position of himself as the Khalifa of all Muslims around the world. So Hijaz, Makkah, Medina being a place of pilgrimage, Sham also being a very holy region, linking it to Istanbul, the capital of the Caliphate. Unfortunately, that did not materialize either, but he actually commissioned German architects to build that, but it had entered war and he had been deposed by the time it actually came into effect. Relations with other powers. So let's begin with the Europeans. And by the way, I'm literally whizzing through history. Right, so forgive me if it's not as detailed as some of you may have expected, and inshallah we can pick up some of the things in Q&A. The Byzantines. Now, for those of you who know early Islamic history, we know that from the Battle of Tabuk, that there was we were in a state of warfare with the Byzantine Greeks, or the Eastern Roman Empire. And that continued right through to the Umayyad period, right through to the Seljuk period, right through to the Ottomans, who essentially finished the Byzantine Roman Empire when they took Constantinople in 1453. It was always a hostile relationship. France was an ally of the Ottoman Empire for 200 years, at least under the reign of Caliph Suleiman I and King Louis. For that 200 years, the French were the main, if not the sole, allies of the Ottoman Empire. The Austrian Habsburg Empire, a very hostile relationship from the siege of Vienna to the Battle of Morwax, from the annexation of Hungary. After the Byzantines, it was the Habsburg Austrians who were kind of the main adversaries of the Ottoman Empire. But in the last 150 years, so we're talking about the beginning of the 19th century right through to World War I, Russia was practically the arch enemy of the Ottoman Empire. And the reason why that is because there was a number of transgressions and a number of annexations by the Russian Empire, at least in the Balkans and Eastern Europe. But what made Russia unique in its adversary to the Ottomans was that it used to exert itself as a protector of the Orthodox Christians within the empire. There was no other European empire that used to emphasize their role and their influence, even when it came down to agreeing on treaty clauses that we are the protectors of the Christians in your state. And of course, the Russians also played a very key role in starting a number of separatist movements in the Balkan region. And a lot of the land that was initially lost in the mid-19th to late-19th century was to Russia. Germany was a fairly new state. We saw that Otto von Bismarck spoke highly of Wilhelm II. And of course, the Kaiser himself was very fond of the Ottoman Empire. And they were the final allies when they entered World War I. And I put Britain and France as the annihilators. And the reason why I put them as the annihilators is because they were the ones who delivered the final blow to the Ottoman Empire. You may be thinking, well, hold on, France was like friends for 200 years. Yeah, that changed. And whenever Britain and France used to have their... How can I put this? Their conflict with the Ottomans wasn't so overt. It wasn't so direct as the Russians and the Habsburg. It was more clandestine from the perspective of commissioning missionary work in the Ottoman Empire, teaching ideas such as nationalism and secularism within the empire, doing a number of things in North Africa and the Middle East. Very rarely did you find open conflict prior to World War I with Britain and France. There were some conflicts, but in comparison to the Habsburgs and the Russians, it was incomparable. But they were the two powers who delivered the final blows to the Ottoman Empire after World War I. In terms of the relation with Muslim powers, the Safavids were Shia Persian Empire. The relationship with them was generally very hostile, with exception to a few small interval periods of peace. There was a lot of land grabbing in modern day Iraq and Iran, as well as Azerbaijan. So it was not only politically hostile, it was theologically and religiously hostile as well. And every time there was a campaign against the Safavid Empire, it would be emphasized that we represent the mainstream normative Sunni population of the Islamic world, and we're going to fight the Safavids who are 12 Shias. This was a common campaign called a war cry whenever there was a war with the Safavids. The Mamluks were a very noble dynasty themselves. They did great things for Islamic civilization in history. They were essentially the dynasty who fought off the Mongols in the Battle of Anjalut. Anjalut, yes. And the same people, rahimahullah. It was ultimately the Mongols who defeated the Mongols. And however, towards the end of the time, and it was also that Mongols who gave protection and preserved the Abbasid lineage. But towards the end of the time, a number of Islamic scholars and historians have argued that they became somewhat corrupt. It was certainly something that was used by the Ottomans. The Ottomans argued that when holding the Mamluks, they've abandoned the concept of jihad, they've abandoned the concept of expansion, they've abandoned the concept of spreading the Islamic domain, they've become more corrupt, they're concerned about how to pillage and loot their own people. I can only assume that was a political propaganda campaign, but point is, the Mamluks did do great things for their respective period, but the relationship with them was very hostile. After they were defeated in the Battle of Marj Dabiq under Salim I, there was no Mamluk state. However, Mamluk beys and sheikhs and elders and influential still remained in Egypt. And for at least 200 years, there'd be a number of attempts at coup d'etats, there'd be a number of uprisings and rebellions, until it was under Muhammad Ali Pasha, the very powerful governor of Egypt, that one day he called all the Mamluk elders that remained in Cairo, said, look, let's find this out, let's talk about power sharing, and he assassinated every single Mamluk elder that existed, and that was practically the end of the Mamluk lineage. But the relationship with the Mamluks and the Ottomans was generally very hostile and very antagonistic, because they were seen as agitators of uprisings and rebellions, at least in Egypt. And last but not least, the Mughals. Can must see a show of hands of whose ethnic origin or parents come from the Indian subcontinent. Okay. The Mughals had a very warm relationship with the Ottomans, to the extent that the Mughals acknowledged the Ottomans as the rightful caliphate, as the rightful caliph of the global Muslim nation. And this has been documented between letters that were sent to the Ottoman Sultan from Aurangzeb, to Babur, to a number of Mughal rulers who, when they used to write letters to Ottomans, to the Ottomans, and the emissaries who used to come, they should address them as Amir al-Mu'mineen or Khalifa al-Muslimin. This is how they used to address them. It has also been documented that under some areas of the Mughal Empire, every Friday during Salat al-Jum'ah, there will be salutations and praises made to the Ottomans within the Mughal Empire. So their relationship was very warm, to the extent that in the 18th century, there were even a number of campaigns that they had fought together, at least politically, to counter the British and the French and the Portuguese in the Indian subcontinent. That's generally the relationship the Ottomans had with their respective powers and empires at the time. Reasons for decline. Now, I've heard a number of Islamic scholars and Western academics try to pinpoint a specific reason as to why the Ottoman Empire declined. I've heard certain Islamic scholars say that they moved away from Islamic monotheism, that they had way too much innovation into their empire. I've heard another Islamic scholar say that the reason why the Ottomans declined was because of the printing press. I've also heard a number of Western academics, like Professor Bernard Lewis, argue that basically they were just not modern enough, and there was a number of economic regressive policies and so forth. Humbly speaking, I don't think we can pinpoint one particular factor. There were a number of factors which contributed towards the decline of the Ottoman Empire. Some played a bigger role than others, and they took part in different periods of time. So let's go over some of them. So when I said to you that one of the characteristics of the Ottoman Empire was its impressive degree of administration, well, it also became a problem for them because, quite frankly, to govern an empire that vast at a time when communication was very difficult was inevitably going to cause problems. So one of the ways the Ottoman rulers had planned to counter this was to allow an impressive degree of autonomy to their governors. When that happened, those governors, to name two particularly, so Mehmed Sokul Pasha, who was the de facto ruler of the Ottoman Empire for 14 years after Suleiman I, Muhammad Ali Pasha, who practically governed North Africa and the Levant, they were given autonomy in a way to overcome administrative problems. When they were given autonomy, they became power hungry and it opened the gates to corruption. That's one reason. Another reason, intellectual decline. So there was a period whereby the Ottoman scholars and Islamic thinkers had codified Hanafi fiqh into law. And when they had codified Hanafi fiqh into law, they had essentially closed the gates of ijtihad, the deductive analogy. And what that basically means is that the Islamic scholars within the Ottoman Empire had felt that the laws and the canons they had was sufficient for all times. Right up until Yom al-Qiyam, that's it. We've got all the laws that we possibly need. There's no need to do ijtihad in new realities. And many have argued that this intellectual decline not only prevented modernity, but it pushed many elements within Ottoman society to look towards other empires and states and powers to revive and have more of a dynamic approach to new realities. So the intellectual decline is one thing which many scholars and academics have argued. The decrease in military campaign. Now remember in the timeline I included that period of 1740 to 1768, that 28-year period of peace. Dr. Virginia Aksan, a very famous Ottomanist historian, in her book Ottoman War 1700 to 1860, she wrote, "The empire continued to maintain a flexible and strong economy, society and military throughout the 17th and much of the 18th century. However, during a long period of peace from 1740 to 1768, the Ottoman military system fell behind that of the European rival." And this was echoed by another famous Ottoman historian, Sarai Faruqi. The reading list is in your handout. She wrote, "Moreover, in the 18th century, when expansion definitely had ended, Ottoman military effectiveness and Sultanic concern for army reform were not totally at an end. So, this 28-year period of peace, whereby there were no major military campaigns, east, west, nor forsouth, you have to appreciate that prior to 1740, the Ottoman state was in a constant state of war and expansion for 4 years. Let that sink in. 441 years, the Ottomans were in a constant state of expansion and military campaigns. So, in that light, to have a 28-year period of peace, it was inevitable that their respective and neighbouring counterparts in Europe were naturally going to utilise this time, this period where the Ottomans put their foot off the gas, and were going to start developing their militaries and start advancing technologically and so forth. Why they had that 28-year period of peace, historians differ. But from my understanding, it was the case that by 1740, the Ottoman Empire had reached such a pinnacle, it was so financially strong that it basically just enjoyed its fruits. 441 years of campaigns, it just enjoyed life. And I'm assuming after 441 years of war, they probably wanted a breather as well. So I feel that this was a key contributor to decline. Nationalism. The spread of nationalism spread like wildfire in Europe. Essentially, with an ideology or a way of thinking that was born out of the Enlightenment and then the Christian Reformation, and the concept of nation state worked wonders for Europe. You can't deny that. It worked wonders for Europe. But the concept of statehood from the perspective of shared culture or ethnic or racial values, it was unheard of in Eastern Empires. When I say Eastern Empires, I'm including the Mongols and the Chinese empires and other empires. The very notion that a state could exist on the premise of some ambiguous values of shared culture or nationality or race or ethnicity, it was unheard of. However, it's not a surprise that it gained momentum within the Ottoman Empire. Why? Because it was so diverse. So you had Armenian nationalism, Greek nationalism, Serbian nationalism, Assyrian nationalism, Arab nationalism at the very end. So nationalism was strategically used, at least by a number of European powers, namely Britain and France, to destabilize the Ottoman Empire. But that's not to say that there weren't organic calls by certain elements and demographics and constituencies within the Ottoman Empire who did want to break away from the empire and create a state like other Western European nations had at the time, based on shared cultural values or ethnicity or race and so forth. The Young Turk Movement. The Young Turk Movement, I know there's a huge misconception, and I know some may disagree with this, that the Young Turk Movement are Western agents, European agents. I'm not denying that many of the leaders were probably collaborating on collusion with Britain and France. However, at least the lower level soldiers, these were guys that basically have felt that the Ottoman Empire was declining. It was on the verge of destruction. And they felt that the only entities at the time that had the answers for revival was Western Europe. So they wanted to modernize the state. They wanted to secularize the state. They wanted to get rid of this religious dogma, this kind of very pan-Turkish tribal approach to state policies, right? But the leadership of the Young Turk Movement, who later became the Committee for Union and Progress, were ultimately removed by Hamid II, they were openly, and it's documented, in collusion with Britain and France. They used to, after Hamid exiled the Young Turks, they were given protection in Paris. And they came back in 1908 to create the Young Turk Revolution. And it's kind of linked with the concept of nationalism, because the Young Turks had two movements within the movement. There was the movement for liberalization, and there was the movement of ultra-Turkish nationalism, which Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, he was of that thinking. And last but not least, the Ottomans were just surrounded by stronger, more advanced European powers. Ultimately, that's what it boiled down to. By the late 19th century, as they entered World War I, that was the reality. Now, all of these things that I've just addressed are contributors. They are all contributors to Ottoman decline. If you were to ask me, Dilly, what do you think were key contributors? Which played a bigger role than others? Number one, intellectual decline. No matter how regressive or backward you may think a polity or a state is economically or socially, I personally feel, and history has proven this, that if a polity or an empire is intellectually sharp, most things tend to catch up. Let me give an example. The early Islamic generation, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa when they perceived as backward, as desert Bedouins and nomads coming out of a place which the Persians and the Byzantines didn't even bother conquering. Some would argue that some of their lifestyle was quite backward and not different, but yet, intellectually, they were on a different level to the Persians and the Byzantines. So I feel that intellectual decline, where you lose faith, where you lose confidence, where you lose conviction in your own philosophy, in your own religion, that naturally that opened the doors to start looking for answers elsewhere. The spread of nationalism. We know the many hadith where Prophet ﷺ very, very strongly condemned the concept of asabiyya and tribalism, right? And that manifested into the idea of the nation state, and that naturally got into the minds of many senior Ottoman officials. And last but not least, the fact that during whilst all this was happening, the European empires were getting stronger from industrialization, from the fact that their weaponry and so forth were far more advanced. Also, the fact that many had, through their very strong navies, had they found new lands in the West, right, and in Africa, right, these lands that apparently never existed. So obviously they accumulated a number of wealth and revenue from that, which essentially made them stronger. So those are some of the key reasons for decline. The Ottoman Empire was not a utopian empire. It was not a utopian society. And anyone who remotely argues this is quite frankly ignorant. Why? We, as Muslims, don't even attribute the concept of a utopian society to Medina under Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We don't apply the concept of a utopian society to the Khulafa al-Rashideen, who are the four rightly guided caliphs, who are promised Jannah on earth. So how could anyone apply the concept of a utopian society or a utopian state to the Ottomans? They had their shortcomings. They had their failures. They made many major mistakes. Let's go over some of them. The policy of world fratricide that was implemented by Mehmed II, the conqueror, the great conqueror, was prophesied. He implemented this state law that the brother who would assume power would have to kill all of his brothers, not just exile them to some faraway palace. They'd have to be killed with a silk rope, right? This was given the green light by some of the ulama at the time, the scholars, to say that, for the sake of the unity of the state, to prevent civil war, to prevent what happened under the Ottoman interregnum between 1402 to 1413, under the three sons of Sultan Bayezid, which nearly destroyed the state, to prevent that, we need to have the policy of world fratricide. In hindsight, we can now look at this policy and say, this can't be from Islam. But that's because that's the beauty of hindsight, quite frankly. At the time, that was the context and understanding of the policy. The proliferation of the usage of eunuchs, grown men who had been castrated, who had been utilized in royal palaces as servants, and they were castrated so they wouldn't look at the concubines of the Ottoman Sultans of Khulafa, or that they wouldn't look at the women and the relatives of the Sultan. I don't know how you can argue the usage of eunuchs. The Ottomans weren't the first, but it was the usage of white eunuchs was widespread under the Ottoman Empire. Allah knows what was the thinking behind that. But I cannot stand here and say to you that this is something that was normative or mainstream or orthodox. And they weren't the first, but they certainly did utilize eunuchs within their royal palaces. Slave trade. There's a huge misconception that the Ottomans were involved in the transatlantic slave trade. No, they weren't. The slave trade that the Ottomans were involved in was the procurement of slaves from war, which was a tradition and a practice that had existed for thousands of years, whereby in a military campaign, if a city or a town or a particular land was taken by force, by military campaign, the prisoners of war would be taken as slaves unless they were ransomed, and that they were then used for labor or then sold on. The same kind of applies for concubines. But let me just explain something to you about concubines, brothers, sisters, and friends. And I'm not justifying, I'm not here to justify concubines or nothing like that. I'm just saying that there was a period called the period of the Sultanas, where for 130 years after the death of Khalid Suleiman I, the Ottoman Empire was practically run by the mothers and the wives of the Khulafa, because a lot of the Sultans were very young. And they did it very methodically and successfully. They played a key role in policy decisions. And guess what? A lot of the mothers and the wives of the Sultans were initially concubines. They were Greeks, they were Armenians, they were Russians. They became the wives and the queens of the empire. Just give me that bit of context. So we need to distinguish between the transatlantic slave trade, which was distinctly white and European, whereby certain European powers, namely America and France and others, would go into Africa and enslave free men and women without there being a military campaign, in comparison to the kind of traditional forms of slave trade whereby you procure prisoners of war or concubines as a result of military campaigns. If you had no use for them, they'd be sold into slave markets. In fact, that was one of the reforms of the Tanzimat, to abandon the practice of slave trade. The system of devishim, whereby a Christian boy from each Christian household from the age of 8 to 18 would be taken from their families. This was justified under the pretext of blood compensation. So again, if there was a particular land or a region or a town or a city that was taken by conquest and Muslim soldiers had died, the policy of the devishim was basically, you will compensate us for the Muslim soldiers that were lost in battle by giving us one of your sons. Now, the Christian households that only had one son, they were exempt. But those who had more than one son, they were taken. If we speak to Serbians and Cossacks and Greeks and Armenians today, you will hear a number of grievances and justified, right? The fact that, you know, boys were taken forcibly from their households. But again, I have to provide you some context. And it's not apologies, I have to give you the context. A lot of these Christian boys went on to become very powerful and influential soldiers. They went to become very influential statesmen. Some of them, after they became Muslim, became grand viziers. They became an elite within themselves. Some Christian families, it's been documented that, and Professor Bernard Lewis actually said this, he said some Christian households used to foldly give their children. So you say take more than one son. I'm not saying that was the case for all of the households, for sure. But I'm saying there were instances because they knew the kind of lucrative lifestyle that some of these boys, who would later become soldiers and politicians and viziers, would have for their families back in their respective areas. But again, you can understand that taking of Christian boys as forced conscription, how that could be argued quite strongly as something that was un-Islamic, something that was ajeeb, something that was never practiced by any other dynasty or state prior to the Ottomans. But again, how did they justify it? They justified it from the ijtihad of basically blood compensation. All the Muslim soldiers that were lost in battle, as a form of repayment, we're going to take one Christian from each household. That's how they justified it. Many ulama from the full madhhab of today have argued that this was, quite frankly, an un-Islamic policy. The Hussain Yilmaz, he actually argued against it from the perspective that it was just. An opinion that Mullah I had adopted and then it became state law. But perhaps the one event or incident which has tarnished the legacy of the Ottomans is what's known as the Armenian Genocide in 1915 between April to August. I'm not going to delve too much into this, but I will say this much. The dominant narrative is that 1.5 million Armenians were systematically killed and raped and put into concentration camps and forced into exile. That's the dominant mainstream take on the Armenian genocide. But since I'm giving you all a lecture on Ottoman history, I have to give you the Ottoman perspective. And the Ottoman perspective to what's known as the Armenian genocide was a case of treason and sedition. During World War I, there was a campaign, the Caucasus campaign. The Caucasus campaign neighbored the region which the Armenians of the Ottoman state had resided in. The Ottomans wanted soldiers from their Armenian subjects or citizens. They wanted 2,000 soldiers. The Armenians, I think, there's a difference of opinion, some get, they gave 250 or 500 Armenian men to join the Ottoman military effort. On top of that, there's also documented correspondence between Armenian elements, namely the thinkers, the philosophers, and the Russian Empire at the time, to basically establish their own state, which was known as the Armenian Liberation Front. So if you look at it from that perspective, from the Ottoman perspective, they had a huge constituency within their empire, or their state, tax-paying citizens, who they gave security and protection to, and they were collaborating with another empire, or another state, that they were in a state of war. So it was perceived as an act of treason and sedition. Dare I say that there may be even some similarities to one of Breyer, for those of you know the story. And that it was a collective punishment that was given out. And the collective punishment that was meted out to the Armenians was exile. They were exiled towards Syria. And in that perilous journey, according to the Ottoman chroniclers and historians, many died. I can't really say whether 1.5 million died, but I'm very sure thousands upon thousands did die. Also, I'm pretty sure that there were elements within the Ottoman army who had committed injustices. Because by that time, brothers, sisters and friends, the Ottoman Empire wasn't really an Islamic state. After the deposing of Abdullah Hamid II, ultimately the three pashas from the Young Turk movement, or the Committee of Progress and Union, ultimately these guys ran the state. And they were ardent nationalists. Right? So that's the Ottoman perspective. The Armenians were exiled for colluding with the Russians, for not giving a sufficient required amount of their men for the war effort, and therefore the collective punishment was exile, and during the exile towards Syria, many died. That's the Ottoman perspective. And it has been challenged and it has been questioned by genocide specialists, but that's the Ottoman perspective. And lastly, this notion that the Ottomans were the sick man of Europe, this was a term that was coined by the Russians and then it was repeated by the British and the French media at the time. Yes, the Ottomans were technologically back or pretty late. They weren't as advanced as their respective European counterparts. But if the Ottomans were really the sick men of Europe, would they have won the Battle of Gallipoli? Or would they have won the Battle of Uhud in Iraq during World War I? Which has been identified as two of the biggest losses to Allied forces in World War I. They were that sick, that outdated, they were not able to accomplish those military victories. It was only, I would argue, through the Arab revolt that they managed to have destabilized and successfully beaten the Ottoman Empire. So yes, the Ottomans, at least going well into the mid to late 19th century as they entered World War I, yes, they weren't as advanced and military prepared or economically strong or intellectually on point as their European counterparts, but they were far from being the sick man of Europe. And those, brothers and sisters and friends, are the main negatives. But we have to be very important when reading history of distinguishing facts and propaganda. To conclude, why are the Ottomans so important to Muslims today? Number one, they were the last embodiment and manifestation of a central Islamic authority. For all the shortcomings and the failures and whatever it may be, they were the last seat of the Khilafah. an institution that was left to us after Prophet Salman and his forefather of our Rajani, and through a number of dynasties, they were the last seat of the caliphate. And not only that, there's an element of connection that Muslims in 2018 are able to have with the Ottoman history. Why? Because when you think about the rightly guarded caliphs, or the Umayyads, or the Abbasids, or the Mughals, or whichever dynasty, or the Socotra Caliphate of Africa, whatever it may be, in terms of time and distance, the Ottomans are very close to us. Only 94 years ago, some of our grandparents or great-grandparents would have known who the Ottomans are. Constantinople or Istanbul is only a 3-hour flight from here, right? They existed in a century where we all, I think, lived. Not many millennials we have here, but I'm just saying. So in that regard, we can kind of understand and connect with Ottoman legacy from a perspective of time and distance. And for those of you who are from the Middle East and North Africa, we'll know that the socio-political and economic reality of those lands today is as a direct aftermath of the defeat of World War I and the European colonial legacy of the Sykes-Picot Agreement. So the situation in North Africa or the Gulf region, those straight lines that you see in a atlas or in a map, was as a result of Britain and France annexing and deciding how the Ottoman territories would be taken. And last but not least, a number of Islamic revivalist movements that came in the early 20th century, they looked towards the Ottomans for inspiration, because the struggles were similar. This struggle with the concept of nationalism and nation-state and secularism, and what was the role of religion in terms of state policy and the public sphere, and all of that. What were the causes of decline? So a number of Islamic revivalist movements looked towards the legacy of the Ottomans as a source of unity and revival. That image there is of Turkish protesters when the attempted coup took place in Turkey, I believe, the year 2 years ago. Obviously, that's the flag of the Republic. And that green flag is the flag of the Ottoman Caliphate, with three presidents representing, of course, Africa, Asia, and Europe. So this is why the legacy of the Ottomans and its history is important to us. Because 625 years of it makes up Islamic civilization. So, you know, we can't just ignore that, right? And they're the most closest to us. And there is a plethora of reasons and realities which we are experiencing today that the Ottomans also faced more than 100 years ago. JazakAllah khairan, thank you for your patience. So any questions and answers, if you can keep it on topic, please. If you start asking questions about mammals and stuff like that, what we do on Friday, but let's keep it on topic, please. Okay.
Yeah, kind of khilafa, it was a specific type of khilafa. My first question would be, how would you go about re-establishing that? Do you think you should re-establish it, number one? And number two,
He basically said a lot of it was positive, but I'm sure he included a lot of negatives. This is for the issue of units and stuff, it's positive a lot of them, right? So, was the Ottoman Caliphate unique? Yes, it was. It was unique, as Hussein Yilmaz and others have said, it was distinctly Hanafi, distinctly Maturidi, distinctly Sufi, in comparison to the Abbasids, who were generally Shafi'i, and the theological take on things was slightly different, as well as the Umayyad. They were different in that regard. Was it all positive? Far from it. There's a lot of negatives, and I explained that. As for the re-establishment of an institution called the Khilafa, right. Let's put aside, first and foremost, legal disclaimers. In case we have any parentheses here. Right? The bastardization of the concept of the Khilafah by the criminal organization called ISIS, let's put that aside. There is no ulama, there is no Islamic movement, there is no constituency or demographic within the 1.6 billion Muslims within the Ummah who recognize this entity as a legitimate Islamic state. Let's put that aside. With regards to should it be re-established, it will be re-established. You can't even say the crap. It will be re-established. Prophet Sallam, he emphasized this in the famous hadith in Muhammad Ahmed, where he said, after Nabuwa, there will be khilaf al-Rashidin, then we'll enter kingship, or paraphrasing, we'll enter kingship, and the biting tyranny, then it will be taken away, and then it will be revived again upon the methodology of the Prophet Sallam. And we'll handle the Nabuwa. Inshallah. Say inshallah, brothers and sisters. And let's not be scared either. Why? Let's not be scared of this concept. Oh my God, I can mention Islamic because, you know, it's all about head dropping and hand dropping. Oh, let's calm down. For more than 1300 years, whether it was the Khulafa al-Rashidin, whether it's the Umayyads, whether it's the Abbasids, whether it's the Ottomans, those polities had the modern trappings of the state for their respective times. For 13 centuries, neither of those dynasties or polities were perceived as backward. So there's no reason that if a polity of this nature was to re-emerge in our lifetime, inshallah, why it shouldn't have the same trappings, if not more advanced trappings, of a modern state. Right? With regards to how it would be established, now we know that a number of groups of movements differ in this regard. Some will say that we will wait for Imam Mahdi to come, but this is not the orthodox normative view of Sunnis, because we know that Imam Mahdi will come to see the Khilafah already established and there will be a dispute for leadership. Others will say that we have to work on our tarbiyah and self-reformation until we become a nation worthy of victory on earth, that it will come. Others will say, well, no, we have to rally certain elements within the ruling elite of the Muslim majority world, be it the military, be it powerful politicians. Others will say, no, we will fight. We will fight and take the authority by force. So there's a number of different perspectives and different ijtihads as to how this Khilafah will be established. All I can say is that I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we see to live that time. And we shouldn't be worried or scared about this, brother and sister. We shouldn't. Because this notion of a nation state is new. It doesn't represent the default. When did the secular liberal nation state ever represent the default? This is a reality of now, last 100, 150 years at best. What? So in that regard, we shouldn't be scared. One of the strategies of colonizing the Muslim mindset, the Muslim psyche, is to abandon this concept, to abandon this political unity which transcends borders, ethnicities and race. And you can't tell me that it's a dream. You can't tell me it was a dream. Because it existed. And it did transcend borders and race and ethnicities. Inshallah it can again. If Europe can unite after two world wars, yeah? Why can't the Muslims unite? We ain't had no wars like that. Right? So if they can unite, inshallah the Muslims can unite also. It's not a far-fetched idea. Brother there.
When was the Turkey plan changed? Who changed it? And what's the detriment of it having changed? Okay.
So, one of the overnight reforms that were implemented by the Young Turks or the Committee of Union and Progress under Kemal Atatürk, he literally overnight got rid of the Arabic language or the Arabic letters from Ottoman Turkish and replaced it with the Latin language. But it's not, we shouldn't see it as the binary replacement of Ottoman Turkish, which was in Arabic, with the Latin. No. If you speak to many Ottoman historians and Turkish scholars, they'll say that what actually happened was the spirit of the language was taken away. Certain expressive terms that were very common within the empire had been taken away. So it wasn't just the language change, right? Which was the kind of the last nail in the coffin in terms of intellectual decline. That was the last nail in the coffin. Because literally, Kemal Atatürk overnight had implemented these very ardently secular policies, right? What were the ramifications of it? The ramifications of it was that there was a huge disconnection between those Turks who were born in that period and their connection with their Ottoman legacy. And a connection with the Islamic culture and legacy of the Ottomans. Because as I mentioned, the Ottoman Empire was proudly Turkish but pan-Islamic. It was pan-Islamic. Its official state language of Ottoman Turkish was heavily influenced by Arabic and Persian. So to cut that umbilical cord, linguistically, is to cut that umbilical cord to your descendants and your great rich history. So that was one major ramification. We need to move away from this kind of Arabic was replaced with Latin. Yes, that took place, but it was the spirit of the language. the expression of that language, what that language represented. Because I personally believe that if you can replace any language with any language, right? But as soon as you literally remove scholastic and religious expressions or cultural expressions, that's a different matter which the Kemal Ataturk did. Sister there. Apologies for my fingers.
Alhamdulillah.
Zahra, thank you for that question. Sister asked whether that didn't address much of the economic aspects of the empire. Forgive me. Perhaps I think I did stress on other aspects of the estate as opposed to the economic aspects. The thing is, in terms of living lavish lives and overindulgence, so this happened right even during the time of Umar al-Khattab, where he would meet certain governors. And they should be scared that because they should dress excessively and extravagant. And this kind of snowballed into lavish lives, which a number of Umayyad rulers and certainly the Abbasids did. And of course, the Ottomans did. For those of you who have been to Istanbul and been to Topkapi Palace, it is nothing but overindulgence, right? However, in terms of its role, in terms of decline, there is an argument that after the Crimean campaign of the 19th century, the Crimean War, that was the first time that the Ottoman Empire had fallen into debt with Britain and France, and that debt had accrued interest. Prior to the Crimean War, it was unheard of to have interest-based loans or debts, unless it was practiced by Jewish financiers, which it was halal for them within the empire. But for the empire, they were not allowed to give or take any kind of interest-based loans. It was after the Crimean War that the Ottoman Empire fell into big debt with Britain and France, and those debts had accumulated interest. And the reason why they fell into debt, because that was a joint campaign against the Russians to prevent Russian advancement in Crimea, and the Ottoman army faced huge losses. And to rebuild the army required money which they did not have, so they got the money from Britain and France. And that basically accrued interest. Was that a standalone reason for decline? No. But you have to also appreciate that once they had that 28-year period of peace, that military campaigns and warfare was a source of revenue. It was a source of revenue. Ghanima, booty, tax, all of this stuff contributed economically to the strength of the state, not just the Ottoman Empire, but any state. Right? So for 28 years, when they stopped those military campaigns, and whilst respective European powers were well on their way in exploring different lands and carrying out their own military campaigns, naturally the kind of fiscal comparison and differences between the Ottoman Empire and their respective adversaries, there was a huge difference. Overindulgence is something which a number of Islamic dynasties and rulers had unfortunately got into system. It wasn't just exclusive to the Ottomans. That would happen under one
Khalifa. Maybe they had a better attitude, maybe their wealth is affecting them in their hearts, and then later on, maybe their hearts became more corrupt,
Allahu Alam, I can't really commit in the state of the heart the rulers who are to meet or converse with.
I know you can't know that, but I just mean, possibly. Any cases of that, can we know about their attitude towards their wealth? How did they treat the poor people in their society? Did that change?
So in terms of the waqf and the collection of zakat, the distribution of that in terms of looking after widows and orphans and so forth, right? And the creation of public hammams, this was a manifestation of the concern that successive Ottoman rulers had towards providing a welfare to their citizens who weren't that well off, right? But if you're asking me, was there a connection between the spiritual decline or overindulgence and how that manifests into state policy, From my reading, I've not really seen a connection between that, because it could be argued that from as early as Sultan Orhan, who was the second ruler, or Sultan Murad the first, that there was a level of indulgence then, but they looked after their citizens. You can read it, and forget Muslim and Ottoman historians, let's just look at Western scholars, right? Western Muslim scholars, the likes of Professor Bernard Lewis, he said that even up until the 19th century, the degree of welfare within the Ottoman Empire was very advanced. But that's not to say that there weren't shortcomings and failures. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that there may have been a spiritual decline. The very fact of an overindulgent and extravagant life is an indication of a spiritual faulting. But I can't really comment. I know you're asking me to comment on that. But was there a link between the spiritual decline or this kind of overindulgence and the way they treat their poor? From my reading, I don't think there was. Because they stressed a huge importance on the role of the waqf and the collection of jizya and zakah and its redistribution.
Was there a connection between the Ottoman rulers and the increased nationalism across the Ottoman and Arab nationalism turning
nationalism? Okay, so if you look at the birth of Turkish nationalism, that was essentially, it began during Mahmud II. And Mahmud II, if you recall, he was known as the Modernist, right? The Khalifa came after Salim III was assassinated by the Janissaries. So a part of those reforms, which were heavily influenced and inspired by European powers, and namely France and Germany, was that to revive the state, there had to be something which binded its citizens stronger than Ottoman culture or Abrahamic shared values, right? And that's when we started seeing the birth of Turkish nationalism, whereby great influence and emphasis was given to the Turkish identity of the state as opposed to its Islamic identity. Remember, the Turks or the Ottomans were consistently known to be Qaria, apologetically Turk or pan-Islamic in the outlook. That changed with the birth of the Young Turk movement. And one of the strategies to counter that was probably his pan-Islamic worldview and the re-emphasis of the institution of the Khilafah to unite people of different faiths as well as the Muslims mainly. But, as I mentioned, the Young Turk movement had two strands within it. It had the liberal element and the ardent Turkish element, which Kemal Atatürk was born from. And naturally, they were just, it could be argued that they were just a reaction or an inevitable result of a state which had intellectually declined, and they were looking for elsewhere for inspiration. And this is the summa of humanity, that less powerful nations would look towards powerful nations for influence. We can see this in ourselves, the way we dress, the way we live our lives culturally as Muslims, and some of the things that we try to imitate from different cultures and societies. It is the sunnah of humanity that less powerful nations and states and cultures and societies will look towards those who are more powerful or deemed more influential for inspiration. We'll start imitating. And of course, imitation is the best way to compliment, right? So, the spread of Turkish nationalism was a movement which truly grew momentum and took momentum once they were actually in exile. Once Abdul Hamid had exiled them, the Young Turk movement, to Paris, there are accounts that they may have been financially supported by France and Britain. But with regards to Arab nationalism is obviously something which has its own socio-political context. And that is that the lands which were under the rule of the Ottomans, mainly parts of the Maghreb, Libya, Tunisia, Egypt, the Hejaz, Sham, that in these regions there were at times accusations of oppressive rule from certain Ottoman governors, right? That they favoured Turks in positions of authority in comparison to, let's say, the Arab sheikh and tribes of those respective areas. There were those accusations, especially under the ruler Muhammad Ali Pasha, who was the governor of Egypt. But generally speaking, the Arabs and the Turks are coexisting, because you had Kurds, you had Arabs in military positions, but there were instances of certain governors who had oppressive policies, and no doubt that contributed to the grievances, as well as we know that the clandestine operation that Lawrence of Arabia utilized when he went and spoke to the Sharif of Mecca. And the Sharif of Mecca, remember, they were essentially very loyal to the Ottomans, right? But obviously they were inspired, they were told that, well, look, you're Arab, you are the lineage of the Prophet, you guys should be holding power and authority, not the Turks. So I think Arab nationalism is something that's distinct. I think it's something which is uniquely European inspired, as it was within Turkey as well, but it's the way that it was utilized in World War I to destabilize the Ottoman Empire, and I think that was nearly the standalone weapon that destroyed the Ottoman Empire World War I. We've got 5 more minutes. Sister there. Okay. So the period known as the reign of the Sultanas, that happened towards the very end of Khalifa Imam's reign, where his wife, Hürrem Sultan was a Crimean Russian concubine who later became his wife, and she bore him the son that became the Khalifa after him. From Hürrem Sultan onwards for 130 years, we saw that there were a number of young, very young, like pre-puberty kind of Khulafa and Sultan. So they were kind of incapable of ruling. So their mothers would take a very strong role in policy advice, in policy decisions and so forth. Was it positive? What's an indicator? What's the metric that we can measure it by? If we look at the 130-year period of the Sultanah's rule, which is called the Sultanah's rule, right? And it wasn't just exclusively women, but I said there was also the Janissaries, certain Sheikh al-Islam. They went in decline. The 130-year period wasn't a period of decline. It was a period of expansion. It was a period of fiscal progression. So I would humbly say that it was positive. Hürrem Sultan, for those of you who don't know what Hürrem Sultan is, Hürrem Sultan is a very controversial figure in Ottoman history because she was regarded as the kind of de facto string puller had Khalifa Suleiman of the thumb. Well, that's what they said, right? They said that she had him under the spell and all sorts. But the reality is, the Ottoman Empire had reached its zenith and its absolute pinnacle under Khalifa Suleiman I. And it continued after that, military expansion and so forth. So if that's the kind of influence that the powerful mothers and wives had, I mean, no. Very last question.
But how come the Mughals had like a warm and kind stance towards the Ottoman Empire, whereas like the other Islamic empires such as the Mamluks, there was disparity in tension between them? How come like they were different in those regards?
I'm so sorry you had to repeat
so,
that.
So like, do you know how like in your slide you said the Mughals had a warm stance or outlook towards the Ottoman Empire, whereas the Mamluks had a very different and hostile approach towards them? Why was there that difference between
them? Good question. So just to quickly go over that, the brother asked, why was there a different kind of relationship between certain Muslim Eastern empires with the Ottomans? Number one, the Safavids were Shia, they were Persians, and therefore, if you read the history of the Safavid Empire, there was a forced conversion of many Sunnis of that region to become part of the Shias. So there was a theological antagonism between the Ottomans and the Safavids, as well as geopolitical. It turns out there was always constant war in the Eastern Front, and the Safavids represented the Eastern Front for the Ottomans, and obviously there was a theological major difference between them. The Mamluks, the reason why the Mamluks had a very antagonistic and hostile relationship with the Ottomans was that, number one, they were protecting the Abbasid caliphs, right? So for the Ottomans, They respected the normative position that you cannot announce Khilafah when there's a Khilafah already in existence, no matter how useless and nominal and ceremonial it may be. They respected that major opinion that if there's a Khalifa, the second kill the latter. So they never declared it until they defeated the Mamluks, who were protecting and preserving the Abbasid Caliph, and forced them to abdicate the Waqf of the Third. Then they announced the Caliphate. And the Mamluks were a very powerful dynasty of themselves. They were very influential in Egypt. And they've always wanted to kind of return to that glory, so they tend to have played a key role in rebellions and uprisings in Egypt. So that was why there was a very negative and hostile relationship with the Mamluks, because the Ottomans ultimately defeated them. And the loss of the Mughals, they were Hanafis, like the Ottomans, they were Mu'tazili Ash'ari, like the Ottomans. They shared a shared lineage back to the Turks, right? The Mughals also came from the Turks, right? And also because they recognized their political authority. If someone recognized my authority, I tend to like them. So I guess what it was, the Mughals obviously had a more relationship because of religious reasons, because of cultural reasons, as well as the fact that they had utilized the Ottomans as a strategic ally at times of military campaigns, especially against the Portuguese and the British. Back to the brothers and sisters.